welcome to a brand new episode of Sequel Rights, the podcast where we take a look at the franchises that make you go, they made how many of those? And we give each and every sequel a fair trial. My name is Justin Camps, and I'm here with...
Elizabeth Helley.
And...
Tyler Hymanson.
Bam! Elise is back in the office!
Yeah. I've gone through extensive therapy to get over my fear of white people after the first purge.
That's right.
Yeah, she put on the wall that we cannot wear masks while at work. So that was rule number one.
Well, watching Mamma Mia now just makes me think all white people are happy and singing all the time.
Oh, they're so happy. That's right. We are kicking off a brand new franchise, as we love to do, with Mamma Mia, the movie. Not the musical. We didn't go see the musical to talk about it.
No, we could have, but we decided not to. Actually, is Mamma Mia still playing in Vegas? I imagine it probably is.
In Vegas, no.
Oh.
And not in New York either.
It used to play at the Mandalay Bay.
Yeah, no, it's definitely not.
Was it an underwater production?
It was not an underwater production, but you did have to walk past it to go to the House of Blues to see all your punk rock shows.
Aww.
No, I looked and there were no like theater musicals really other than like some Marilyn Monroe musical that was possibly closed. Still listed on Vegas.com. Yeah. So yeah,
anyways, back to the underwater version of Mamma Mia.
It's in Atlantis. It's just inverted on the bottom half of the island.
Before we get too far, let's see what it looks like when you gather a bunch of middle-aged white people together to sing some songs and watch the trailer.
I have a dream, a song to sing, to help me cope with anything.
We're here for the wedding.
You are expecting us.
Oh my God, yeah. Yes.
Mamma mia, here I go again. My, my, how can I resist ya? Mamma mia, does it show again? My, my, just how much I missed ya. Yes, I'm brokenhearted. This is the day we parted.
Is your father here?
You tell me.
Did I ever let you go? Mamma mia.
Ooh, those ABBA tunes.
Is it your boss's retirement party? No, it's a movie.
What's that I hear? ABBA? Must be someone's wedding. It's funny that the whole thing is put around a wedding. It makes so much sense.
Was it written by a wedding DJ?
A sentient wedding DJ.
The group think wedding DJs.
I mean, I'm assuming that they just had to like include certain things to make it fit the songs without changing a lot of the lyrics. So like, yeah, one of the songs mentioned like the wedding is tomorrow, so like, okay, we gotta include a wedding in this. And then one of them's like about traveling.
I like to think that these things come up of somebody who actually has a deep love of ABBA. It's like their favorite band. They've listened to it, and it's just like the images that they conjured. And then like once they listen to it long enough, it's like I have a complete like opera in my head of putting this together.
It's weird. There was actually like a in the 80s there was a children's musical that like went in France and throughout Europe that was already like an ABBA jukebox musical. And then this lady had this idea for Mamma Mia, I guess, and she took it to the ABBA people, and they were like, come back to us and maybe. And then they did, and they were like, okay, yeah, sure. Like, once she had the fully formed idea, and then they made a gajillion dollars.
Completely ignorant here. I realized that this may be the first time I've heard the phrase jukebox musical.
Okay, yeah.
But, so, like, but that makes total sense.
Oh, yeah, it's a thing. So, like,
not jukebox... a big musical guy, Tyler?
I played the saxophone in middle school.
A jukebox musical is like when all these songs, typically from one artist, but sometimes from one era, all come together. And sometimes it's like this, where it's a made-up story using the songs. And sometimes it's like Jersey Boys or Motown, yep, where it actually tells the story of the people and then has the songs as like performances throughout. And this was the first one to really, like, there were a few others in the 70s and 80s and 90s, but this is the first one that really, like... broke out into the mainstream, and it's sort of like simultaneously, you know, loved and reviled by like Broadway people, mm-hmm. because it sort of you know, started this like scourge, I guess you could say, of jukebox musicals, many of which were not good. but also, Broadway was not really doing so great right then. It was kind of like, yep. in a slump as far as its appeal to mainstream audiences, and this really like, you know, started kind of like a renaissance, or, you know, at least brought in a whole bunch of money.
There's a reason that it was playing in Las Vegas.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a there's a Emilio and Gloria Estefan one playing in L.A. right now that makes me want to kill myself.
Oh, my God.
I don't think I'd want to go see it.
I mean, I have season tickets, so I'll be there on Wednesday. Get on your feet. Yeah, I'm
yeah. Okay. Report back next week, actually. That'll be interesting to hear about.
Yeah.
yeah, so the movie is based on this musical. Like you said, created by, you know, together with Benny and Bjorn from ABBA and Katherine Johnson. And it's this huge hit. And apparently in the special features, the entire time they were thinking about, you know, making a movie out of this. Uh-huh. And the same person who directed the original production in the West End and on Broadway directs the Mamma Mia movie.
Which is an interesting choice.
It is an interesting
choice. Did she ever direct any other movies?
I think this is her first film, yeah.
And only?
Oh, I don't know. I don't know about her only. I'm not sure. I could look.
But yeah, it's weird. Like, the even though this musical was insanely popular, it didn't really launch anybody like that you would know off the top of your head. Yeah.
Well, yeah, because
it's kind of interesting, though, that then they got all these big-name people to be in the movie.
Yeah, she did direct The Iron Lady, which was pretty popular.
Another Meryl joint.
Yeah. so, yeah, the director we're talking about is Phyllida Lloyd. I always wanted to say Phyllida in my head. But
Phyllida.
Phyllida Lloyd. And, you know, I of course I got the Blu-ray of this. And one of the main things that they are talking about all over the thing is how this movie and the musical itself is like really brought together by like these three main ladies, Katherine Johnson, who wrote the script and the book for the movie or for the musical, Phyllida Lloyd, and the producer Judy Kramer. Mm-hmm. They're kind of like. In the movie, there's the Donna and the Dynamos.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And they kind of compare themselves to that that group. And
it's autobiographical.
Yeah. So there's kind of like exciting stuff to celebrate about this movie being like totally brought about and created by women. And as we get into it, there's lots of great roles for middle-aged women that you don't find a lot.
Sorry, I was just going to say, did they say it all in the commentary? Why does the Broadway musical or this movie take place in Greece?
I think it might be for one Greek chorus joke.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Is it just for that?
Like, I didn't listen to the commentary. It's too much time.
Oh, okay. Sorry. But yeah, there's a literal Greek chorus throughout this entire movie.
Yeah, and they didn't even really...
borderline racist, but we'll get into that.
They didn't even film that much in Greece, actually.
No.
And also, Tom Hanks and Rita Wilson are executive producers, and she's kind of like Greek-American royalty. So.
Yeah. So pretty cool. That's a little bit of the background. You guys, I was thinking like you want to maybe go through like song by song. I feel like there's so many songs in this movie. And
there is. They're trying to. I think they got all of the songs from the musical except for one that they cut out.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which we can get to.
Yeah.
And I feel like most of the story is done through the songs. So I was like.
And I feel like that now is a point that we can kind of bring up. It's kind of a unique thing here at Sequel Rights where we're talking about a movie. Before the sequel to this movie comes out in theaters.
Mm-hmm.
And I am a ABBA novice. I didn't know that there was this many ABBA songs or really anything else. And I didn't know that Here We Go Again or Here I Go Again was a line in...
You didn't even know that one?
Oh,
Mamma
no,
Mia?
Come on.
No.
Wow.
That's like literally the second line in the song.
Tyler heard Dancing Queen for the first time. Just yesterday.
Yeah. Probably in its entirety, yeah.
Ugh.
Yeah.
Well, it's funny that you say that, though. They do talk a lot about how everyone really like knows these songs, except for Tyler.
Yeah.
They're like in their blood, but maybe they're not really like listening to the lyrics. And when you hear them in this context in the musical, you're kind of like really paying attention to the lyrics more than you might be if you're just like playing the song at a wedding or something.
So my question is, there's more songs?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I don't know how many records ABBA has, but a lot.
And this...
One really famous one that is noticeably absent from this is Fernando. Uh-huh. There's got to be others, I'm sure. But
yeah, we will find out next week.
I just want to bring that
up.
I don't know.
Like, I don't know if the new movie is going to be all other ABBA songs or if they're going to be reprising. It's like
now we're getting into Jimmy Eat World.
And yeah. I would... There's just random other bands in there. That would be weird as hell.
That's right. Now here comes Tom Cruise from Rock of Ages.
And a one. And a two. You know what to do. So
yes, I wanted to bring that up because I was...
Sorry, I was counting.
I was like, this is a lot of episodes.
I'm like, one,
and then
two.
The whole time I'm watching it, knowing there's a sequel, I was like, wait, there's more?
Yeah, there's more. There's eight studio albums.
Oh, God.
I'm sure they had a huge amount of hits, so... You know, they broke through like with Waterloo, which is used in the movie.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
When they won like the Eurovision contest back in the 70s. And
fabulous Eurovision contest.
That's kind of how they broke through to the world.
If you had to make a jukebox musical with a band of your choice.
Oh.
Maybe we don't answer this now. Maybe this is later on, but like.
I already know mine.
I was just thinking, I'm like, I can't stop but think of joke answers. Yeah. I'm like, Dave Matthews band. No.
That's is probably
that,
coming
is that a
soon
joke, or is that a real one?
You caught me, damn it.
With the full cast of Crash. It's called Crash Into You.
Okay, let's make a Crash musical that uses that song. It's like the main song. That would be fucking awesome.
Boy.
Okay, well, let's get back to Mamma Mia. Mamma Mia. So the movie starts out with, you know, it stars Amanda Seyfried as one of the
post Mean Girls, pre Les Mis. So
and
she's
during
like,
Big Love, I think.
Yeah. So she's kind of like known, but this is her first, I think, big solo helming thing.
She looks really
she's
young.
Great. She's like delightful.
She looks really young. Yeah. I think cast because she can semi resembles Meryl Streep's daughter.
Yeah, I thought she was a pretty good singer.
Yeah.
It's funny because
she's one of the better singers in this movie.
Obviously we'll get to the plot is that she's trying to figure out which of these three guys is her dad. And so I was like, well, obviously it's whichever one of the three has the biggest eyes.
That's true.
Because Meryl doesn't have those eyes. So.
You make a good point. So the movie starts right off with, I have a dream. Or I had a dream. Have a dream. And she's like taking a boat from somewhere to go to the mailbox.
That's right.
Yeah, so they live on this fictional Greek resort island where mom, Meryl Streep, runs the like bed and breakfast or something.
Yeah. She runs like a hotel like villa inn. Or something. Yeah.
It's called the Villa Donna.
Oh, I wonder why.
Yeah.
Okay. And so
her favorite Ninja Turtle is Donatello.
So this was also like Meryl Streep's, I think, first time that she did a musical, and then she sort of became fixated and did a few more after this. But there's a pretty famous Modern Family quote about this where Cam is getting mad because some of their gay friends are like, oh, my husband and I rented Mamma Mia, and I don't really know if Meryl Streep was the right choice. And Cam like goes crazy and basically says, Meryl Streep could play Batman and it would be the right choice. But... despite that, I don't know if Meryl Streep is the right choice.
Hey, she sang so well in this that years later they hired her to sing act as the famously horrific and hilarious singer Florence Foster Jenkins.
Florence Foster Jenkins, and she does that, what is it, Ricky in the Flash, where she's like a rock star.
Yeah. Oh,
and then, of course, Into the Woods, where she...
Ricky in the Flash feels a little bit like a Mamma Mia spinoff.
It does. That was a Diablo Cody script, wasn't it?
I think so.
And I think her own daughter played her daughter in that one. So in the beginning, I was
Meryl's making choices for herself.
Super put off by Meryl singing for like the first 2 to 3 numbers. But I would say like around the second half, I sort of came around to it a little bit more when she was doing more of the like heartfelt, like quieter song. Not quieter is not the right word, but the more emotional songs, like the song where they're getting ready for the wedding and she's with the
That's
girl.
The song where it absolutely works.
Yeah, it's slipping through my fingers. And then when she sang Winner Takes It All to Pierce Brosnan, like that, I guess I got it a little more. In the beginning when she's singing Money, Money, I'm just like, this is not, no.
I didn't think she was that bad.
Here's the argument that I have for her is that, like, for having this woman who was, like, incredibly cool to have these three dudes... Like, the premise of the movie, in case you don't know, it's kind of one of those things like The Purge where it's seeped into pop culture. like, there's a 30 Rock episode about this where Tina Fey gets super excited. It's like, it's a Mamma Mia, which is my entire exposure to it. But basically that Amanda Seyfried doesn't know who her dad is because Meryl Streep fucked three dudes in the same summer. And so she invites all of these potential dads to her wedding because she wants to know who her father is.
Yeah, and she's convinced that when she sees them, she'll just know. And that is not the case because white people are white people.
And so for the ridiculousness of this movie, Meryl Streep does embody, like, she's the anchor of, in terms of, this whole premise revolves around her being this magnetic personality. And so... I understand the casting, and I understand why she's there, and I understand that she was like, fuck it, I want to do a musical.
Mm-hmm.
But the singing is not good.
I came around to her. I think she's better in the more
than Pierce
subtle,
Brosnan?
Like, singing to one person as opposed to a huge number really work.
Yeah, I don't know. I thought she was totally fine. And, you know, watching the special features, you can hear some of her, like, singing in the booth, and apparently they gave all the actors options to, like, sing along to the recording live on camera.
Les Mis status.
Yeah, so she apparently sang every time, every take.
Damn.
Even when she's climbing that goat house in the during her signature song, Mamma Mia.
Mamma Mia. Followed by the Greek chorus. That was the first time the Greek chorus really... I mean, they were there for the money, but the first time they started popping up, like, yeah.
I love that. There's all this talk in, like, the beginning of the movie about, like, oh my God, my hotel is so run down and I can't, like, this, don't sit in that chair, it's broken, don't use the toilet, it doesn't flush. And I'm like, no wonder they're fucking not getting anything done. These white people are fucking roping the workers into singing songs every 2 seconds. They're like every 5 minutes they're fucking doing a big musical number and they're roping in the, I know it's supposed to be like the Greek chorus, but it's just like the workers, like, drop what they're doing and start singing with everyone.
Yep.
And they're like, no wonder they're not getting any shit done.
They're scaling walls so they could peek over a ledge at the right time.
There's one lady that's like carrying a bundle
of
sticks.
It's no wonder
that, like,
their economy's in tatters.
Yeah. This island is fucked. If they don't stop singing songs right now, get to goddamn work.
You got to ignore the rhythm.
But so the movie starts out with, like, some killer songs. It's got Honey Honey, where Sophie is, like, reading what must be the lyrics out of her mom's diary.
Yeah.
Kind of like singing about all these encounters. And then it goes into Money, Money, Money. And then they couldn't keep the rhyme going and they sang Mamma Mia after that. But it was funny. Like, you know, as much as I was watching this movie, like, oh, this is so cheesy. And, like, God damn it. Like, every time the song started, I was like, fuck, these are fucking amazing
songs.
These
are great songs.
Well, that's the thing. Like, it sounds so silly how many times they say honey in the first two songs because it rhymes with money. But, like, the whole thing about ABBA was that they started not speaking English.
Right.
And that they just got these songs and phonetically learned them. And so the words are not that deep or complicated.
Yeah, I think somebody or one of the producers or somebody in the band was like, you know, got to change these lyrics to English, especially with like Waterloo. And then it was like a huge hit.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Something about it just, like,
it's crazy to me how much this movie is stilted, like, it conveyances between, right, well, like, here's some people talking, let's get to a point that we have this song. Like, this is the movie why people who say they hate musicals hate musicals.
Yeah.
Because it's just like, now we're going to start singing for, like, for a reason. Like, we're going to set up this premise. But that being said, the songs are so fucking fun.
I know.
So good. that like you're just like eye roll, and yeah. by the time your eyes make it all the way back around, you're like
Mamma Mia.
Well, and it really goes down to also, and I always forget which one is which, so Tyler, you can help me, but there's like the diegetic and the non-diegetic musical numbers,
right,
and which one is which?
Non-diegetic is where it
is like I'm singing all of a sudden and it's advancing the plot. Yeah. And diegetic is when like, and now we're performing. And
right. It's like in the yeah. in the yeah, real
like,
world.
Exactly.
Yeah. It's like yeah.
Our songs play how it goes.
Yeah. yeah. And so the fact that they have this device of Donna and the Dynamos, like this little singing group that Meryl is in with her two friends, like, and some of the songs are purely just like them singing performing. As a performance. And I almost wish that they had leaned into that a little bit more with like maybe put two or three of the songs over to the other side of being performances, because yeah. some of them are just a little bit, they just don't fit the moment and they are feel really shoehorned in. And I would have just rather had it been like, and now we're performing again.
The
like,
biggest yeah. example I feel like of this is the, and we're skipping in front.
That's fine.
Songs right here. But is the,
is it Take a Chance on Me?
Are you thinking SOS? You don't know the song.
I don't know the song.
You gotta sing it so we know.
I was thinking of the one where it's the bachelor party and he's like,
oh yeah,
and he has like, now I have a cigar.
That is oh gosh,
that's the Voulez-Vous, right?
Super Trooper? No, that's the bachelorette party.
It's before that when she jumps off the boat.
Yeah, I didn't write it down, but I know what you're
saying. Because it's the worst song. Yeah. That's why. That.
I just thought it was really funny, too, how like they're on this tiny little island, and all of a sudden this guy has like 50 bros at his bachelor party, like ready to do a dance number like on the dock. And then all of a sudden they cut to her bachelorette party, and it's like 50 chicks. So like the only people they invited to this wedding were people who also attended the bachelor and bachelorette right, parties. Right.
That song, yeah, the song is Lay All Your Love on
yes,
Me.
Yes, yes.
Where we get to hear the dulcet tones of Howard Stark himself.
Yeah.
I was like, holy shit, is that Dominic Cooper?
Yeah.
Oh, and, God, and his name is Sky? No.
And again, we get another chronicle of Tyler watching a movie on a train.
Oh, no.
Where there's some cool black teenagers, and they glance over, and here's this goofy, nerdy white dude watching a bunch of dudes on the dock dance with flippers on.
That was the dumbest scene. I was like, oh, my God.
And I was just like, Oh no.
I was like, I almost like spit out my drink when yeah. like they're singing you know, like from here to eternity on the beach, like while the ocean's yeah. washing over them, and then like while they're singing, all of a sudden these guys like with scuba gear pop up out of the water,
like the Navy SEALs going to kill yeah. Bin Laden.
And then you can like before they're fully out of the water, and you can tell they're like still would have water in their mouths. You can hear them singing in the backing track, like "Lay All Your Love."
This is one of the major arguments of why you shouldn't allow first time directors to make a giant musical with yeah. a bunch of stars.
Apparently, they were originally supposed to do that whole dance with the flippers on the beach.
Uh-huh.
But they couldn't get the right, like, you know, jumping.
Turns out that's hard.
Yeah. So they're like, let's do it on the pier instead. Yeah.
Well, yeah. And speaking of the director, I mean, I think, though, to give her credit, there are a lot of, like, really beautiful, like, travel porn shots thing. And, like,
absolutely.
A lot of, like, Amanda Seyfried being lit very well in the sunset and things like that. And
not talking shit. This is a very goofy scene. And yeah. Yeah. Black musicals have goofy scenes.
For sure,
and this
yeah.
is the goofiest one.
Yeah.
It's funny. I ended up thinking, like, first of all, I love that this movie has so many people from the musical, the original musical involved, mm-hmm. like the director, the choreographer, the mm-hmm. music director. All people from the musical. But I did end up thinking that a lot of the, you know, in the translation to film, I felt like a lot of the musical numbers were well staged, but the choreography within them was kind of lame.
It was yeah. so simple.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah
it was very
like,
simple.
We could probably learn this with a
yeah,
dance.
Yeah, and the choreographer is on
the
special features like, even if it looks like it's improvised, we planned it.
And guys,
and like,
we
okay.
know about dancing on film.
That's true.
Because we've watched Step Up. And I'm actually kind of not fucking around with this. And that, like, when they were dancing on the dock, I was like, the mob did so much better.
The mob would have owned them.
The mob would have owned this bachelor
yeah,
party.
I guess you just kind of think of, like, how much are they really leaning into the fact that it's, like, these are just a bunch of rando people who are not, like, trained musicians and yeah. dancers, like, the characters. And so that's why the dancing is very, like, do-do-do, like, you know, it looks like wedding dancing, like yeah. YMCA or the Macarena.
But they're in a line all dressed similarly.
And there were a few sequences where the editing was like super hectic, but because it was supposed to be, which kind of like takes away from, you know, certainly what was probably a big choreographed number, but the camera's moving around and following the dads, like when they're doing Voulez-Vous and it's like in the middle of like the bachelor party and the hen's night or whatever they called it.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, and it's like Amanda Seyfried getting like a split second with all the dads. But that was a really hectic scene. I kind of liked it, but it just doesn't get to like kind of showcase all the work that the dancers were doing and stuff. But I don't know. I thought it was cool.
I feel like, the doc scene stands out as something where it's like, I completely agree with what you're saying. Mm-hmm. That scene where they're setting it up as like, these are not just wedding dancers. These are professional dancers in a line dancing on a dock. And they look like Steamboat Willie.
Yeah. How dare you besmirch the good name of Steamboat Willie. So I guess getting back to the characters, we got the three mystery dads, and they are Colin Firth, who used to be a punk guy, I guess.
Harry Bright. Yeah.
Oh, it was
Harry Headbanger Bright. Yeah. And then you've got Stellan Skarsgård, who is Bill Anderson.
Mm-hmm.
He's like a travel writer, right? And he's the adventurous guy. Yeah. And then good old Pierce Brosnan, James Bond himself.
Remington James Bond.
Pierce Brosnan playing the American.
Yeah. Yep.
Was he supposed to be American?
Yeah, he had a U.S. passport.
Yep.
Yeah, but I just thought that he was like... lived in America, but was still British.
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, I guess. He had a U.S. passport, so I was like, okay.
I know he came from the U.S. because I remember him saying, like, in the cab, get me to JFK, but, like, didn't he have a British accent throughout the movie?
He probably did.
He did.
So he is the most curious of the three dads, and he is, like, kind of the lead because he's the one that still has, like, a romantic connection with Donna, Meryl Streep.
Yeah, he came back.
Yeah.
That's right.
And,
but they all came back in a way, because when they all got Sophie's invitation, they were all excited to see Donna again.
Yeah, but he came back before.
That's right. Getting ahead of ourselves, but yes.
He apparently left her, you know, stranded and went off to go back to the girl he was engaged with. And you find out later that he actually came back, but saw that she had moved on with these other two bros. And so he bailed.
You know, this movie has a giant dangling thread, or maybe I missed this. Where Bill's character, Stellan Skarsgård, he has a great aunt named Sophia.
Yeah, they never resolve. It's just a coincidence.
I think that was more like...
A red herring?
Or just like, they say that like, he's like, I heard that she gave her money away to family, and it turned out like that Donna got all her money.
Right.
Yeah, so, but it could be just that she considered Donna
surrogate daughter who took care of her. No one really knew who the kid was with, and maybe her aunt.
Bill thinks that Sophia could be his daughter because her name is Sophia, named after her great aunt, and this hotel, which was apparently Pierce Brosnan's idea on this Greek island, was financed by Bill's great aunt's passing.
Yeah, who Meryl Streep had like taken care of in her old age.
And so, and he was like, I thought she always gave that money to family.
Yeah.
Type of thing. Yeah. And then the movie floats it out there, and then like a balloon escaping a quinceañera, it goes off into the distance and was never retrieved.
I have three dads.
Yeah, I think that was just like supposed to be a red herring, I guess. Like just like how the fact that she can draw a really crappy sketch of Pierce Brosnan and makes you think that then he's her daughter.
But we don't know who.
Or she's his daughter. Yeah, no, we never find out. I mean, spoiler alert, they do a Mamma Mia, like you said, and they decide to say, hey, we're all your dad. Like, and this like goes on to become like a really, almost like a trope. Like they make fun of this like in Glee, like that Rachel has her two dads and she never finds out who it is.
Yeah.
And I think like there's that character in Sense 8 who has three different dads. It's like they just never find out. They're like, oh yeah, like these are my three dads. We don't know which one it is.
Yeah,
my three dads.
More presents at Christmas.
That's right.
Yeah.
So Pierce Brosnan kind of takes, halfway through the movie, kind of takes more of the lead role out of all the dads.
Much to everyone's dismay.
I know, and unfortunately, by the end of the movie, I was like, fuck, does Pierce Brosnan sing the most songs in this movie, or am I just like, he more perturbed every time he sings?
He's the worst.
Bad.
It's like, it's so overwhelmingly obvious that, like, the female talent overpower the male talent as far as singing in this entire movie. Like, none of them can sing. None of the guys can sing.
Stellan Skarsgård sang at all, really. And then Colin Firth had, like, one little nice moment on the boat, but then the other times he sang, it was bad, bad.
It was so funny. The special features, like, for a couple of the guys, like Dominic Cooper and Pierce Brosnan, the musical director says the same thing about both of them. He's like, Pierce tried so hard. He worked so hard. And they're like, Dominic Cooper, he was so scared, but he worked so hard. And they never say, like, he was a great singer to start. It's just always like, he worked so hard.
Yeah, there's
There's a song,
and they don't do anything to help him. Like, they just let it be bad.
And not only does he sound bad, he looks goofy as fuck when he's singing.
Yeah, like, I kept thinking, like, wow, this man is so good looking, but he looks so dumb right now.
Yeah, he just looks like what you would imagine. Like, some, you know, I mean, they're playing dads, so it's just like your friend's dad suddenly jumping into song or something.
There's
like,
one. Well, I guess this. There's one song towards the end where he's giving a heartfelt plea to Meryl Streep, and you could tell that they just like cut out half the song probably because they were like, enough of this. Like, he only sings like one chorus of it, whereas
that
all
I do.
He just,
it was like a half song.
All of a sudden, Meryl Streep just jumps in. She's like, yeah, I do. Let's end this song.
The one thing he's good for, though, is I got to go back and get these, but there are going to be some amazing gifts of Pierce Brosnan dancing because it's so bad. Also, there's an amazing shot of towards the end when like Meryl Streep sings her The Winner Takes It All, like big huge number, like spilling her guts out, and she like runs away from him up this like huge long staircase up to the church, and there's a shot of like Pierce Brosnan still all the way down the stairs, and it zooms in on him and he's like, Donna! So, like, the water crashes behind him and it just looks so dumb.
it's bad.
Yeah. Man. And we should say too that Donna's dynamos are her two friends.
There's friends.
Yeah, Julie Walters and Christine Baranski, who are both like, you know, really well established Broadway singers, and so they kind of back up Meryl and keep her honest, I guess. But
I thought they were kind of annoying like from the get go.
They are kind of incredibly annoying. I did think that Christine Baranski, though, might have been one of the only people that really, really knew what movie she was in and was full on.
That's absolutely correct.
There's a completely extraneous number where she's like flirting with a young male bartender that is just like so stupid, which I was kind of like, do I want this to be cut out or do I think it's great just because she's so funny and she's like just really leaning
into
it. She's
dancing her ass off.
Yeah. There's, okay, so this is actually my favorite visual thing in this movie. It's like, there's hijinks, right? Like there's so many hijinks in this movie where Sophia doesn't tell her mom that she's inviting these people.
Yeah. Everyone's
got schemes, right? And so one of the schemes is that Donna's friends are going to take the other dudes out and distract them for the day
and try to find out like why they're there.
Yeah, and so then Colin Firth is on the boat, a paddle boat with her, and then he ends up jumping off, and then this young bartender jumps on, and she's like doing this amazing like, I have my feet up, I'm not paddling.
She wasn't paddling at all. It was just Colin Firth.
Colin Firth is...
So I assume they were going in a circle.
And he's struggling. Like, he can't get it done. And then, like, while she's trying to get away from this young bartender dude, she just starts paddling. And then it's just like... there's a motor on the boat.
Yeah.
I mean, the whole thing is a stilted reason for a song about, like, I can't take a risk on you type of thing.
It's the MILF song.
Yeah.
It was just, like, so classic. There's a part MILF where she, song. Like, gets on her knees and they don't show what she's doing, and it turns out she was just, like, tucking his towel into his pants to make it look like he was wearing a diaper. Like, it's so stupid. But, like,
you know how you do.
But she's just really funny, and you could tell that she was, like, more than anybody. It was just like, fuck this, I'm hamming it up, you know? And she was playing, like, this, thrice divorced woman who had had all this plastic surgery and whatnot, and she was just so funny. She's like an American treasure.
No, I agree. Like, she knows absolutely what movie she's in.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And there's kind of, like, this weird parallelism between Donna and her two best friends, and Sophia and her... bridesmaids, I suppose?
Yeah, her two completely forgettable generic bridesmaids.
Right. No, yeah. Yeah. They bring them in like, oh, like it's going to be this whole thing. And then they're just there to be young, attractive women, mm-hmm. I guess.
Yeah.
By the way, like, you guys, like, we are three friends and we should really have like a little song that we sing every time we get together, right?
We could do
intro to Sequel Rights every time, but it's not really musical enough.
It's a thing that's a trope in this movie where like the bridesmaids get out and they have a dumb fucking chant. I forget what it is.
Yeah. It's like, and I'm tall, she's small, and you're awesome.
Yeah. Oh, go us.
Yeah.
And then Donna, they have their whole like intro as their doo-wop group.
Yeah.
Doo-wop?
I don't know if it's
They're basically disco. Like ABBA ripoff.
Yeah.
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 I mean, some of the songs, they wrote the song Super Trouper, apparently. They should be megastars.
They said that Harry wrote that song, and she appropriated
it. That's right.
So I'm sure he can sue her for all the royalties.
Yeah. Is that what the movie Super Troopers is named after?
No, it's spelled differently.
But is it S-O-U-P? Is it soup?
No, it's true. T-R-O-U-P. Super Trooper. I was like, one of my...
Well, I have a new idea for a soup restaurant now.
Super Trooper. One of my favorite, like, really short, totally unnecessary scenes in this movie involves the other Dynamo girl, Julie Walters, who plays Rosie Mulligan in the movie. There's a
Hercules
scene...
Hercules Mulligan.
Hercules.
There's a scene...
She gets the fuck back up again.
Yeah, there's a scene where like they're all gonna go like they all split up to go tackle the different dads or whatever, and she's gonna go meet up with
dad
the dads.
Tackles.
Yeah, she's gonna go meet up with the Bill on the boat.
Dad tackles.
Dad tackle. Anyways, so Julie Walters as Rosie Mulligan. She's like, there's this really short scene of her getting on the tiniest raft and pushing it off the pier. And it's just a scene of her like, all right, she's standing up on this raft and she's like, okay, what do I do? And then she totally falls all the way in the water.
Yeah.
And then that was end of scene. And then apparently she swam the rest of the way to the
boat where Stellan Skarsgård gets to make a joke where this is a pretty funny scene. Okay. So at this point, all the dads think that they're Sophia's
the dad.
Yeah.
Right. And so Bill Stellan Skarsgård has it, he's like, I'm not a dad, like that's not my personality. And where Colin Firth is like, oh my god, I've been waiting for this for my entire life type of thing. And they have a conversation where Stellan Skarsgård thinks that Colin Firth has just realized that he's gay.
And Colin Firth thinks that Stellan Skarsgård is freaking out about sleeping with Julie.
Yeah.
Julie Walters.
With an older woman, yeah.
And it's overheard and hijinks ensue again. But there's a joke that's so on the nose that I enjoyed it. where she swims to the boat, she's looking over, and she's like, and Stellan Skarsgård's like, yep, like, oh, you're here, never mind, we'll table this conversation, we're making eggs, like, Sonny's, and so then he stands up, and he's wearing, like and he basically moons the camera, which apparently, like, if you, like, from the Thor movies, like, Stellan Skarsgård will always get naked for your movie.
I guess so,
like,
yeah.
That is something that directors will tell you. Yes.
I forgot about
like,
that.
Dude's gonna get naked. And so he moons everybody, and the joke that he says almost ADR off camera is like, yeah, sunny side up with plenty of ham. Which is just like, Stellan Skarsgård, like, you old, dirty, hilarious man.
So there's supposed to be like this whole romance between them, which I didn't get at all. And so when she first came to the boat, I was like, what's happening? And then I was like, okay, I guess that's a thing. And then at the wedding reception at the very end, there's a whole song of Take a Chance on Me where she's basically like chasing him down to sexually assault him.
Yeah.
And
I felt so awkward that when the way this song starts, she's like,
it's like, I'm going to give a toast. Okay. And then sings a whole song about trying to have sex.
I have to say a thing.
But she says it like sideways to him, like,
as soon as this movie starts, I was like, well, there's three of them.
There's
three of them.
Yeah.
Like, you're going to pair off. Because I didn't know anything about this movie when I, like, started watching it. Like, I hadn't seen the play or whatever.
Yeah.
And when I was like, oh, well, he's gay. Like, okay, so it's not happening. Like, and then, like, when the wedding actually happened, and what happens is that Sophia decides that she's want to get married, and that Pierce Brosnan and Meryl Streep end up getting married.
Mm-hmm.
Not something I saw coming. It was like, oh, they didn't do, like, the thing where they're going to force, these relationships to happen. Like, I'm actually, like, pleasantly surprised by that. That was nice. And then she's like, ding, 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 ding. I'm doing a speech. We're going to be together now. And I'm like, fuck.
Well,
I spoke too soon.
I didn't even get that Colin Firth's character was supposed to be gay when he was having that conversation in the boat with Bill. I thought it was all hijinks and misunderstanding.
Like, I was like, in my notes, I was like, holy shit, does he think he's gay? But I didn't think he was gay. Like, there was no
yeah,
it's lead like, up before
and
that.
And then it's played off. I actually didn't like the way that this was revealed, like, in the wedding scene. Colin Firth is basically like, oh, I never thought I was gonna have kids, and then he like says, he like looks at some dude that he like apparently
he says
just
you're the first woman I ever loved and the last,
and he looks at some dude who like some Greek guy that he apparently like just met there. So I was like, so are they trying to imply that he just figured out he was gay for real? So apparently, like, I mean, I went and like looked this up in the for the musical. Apparently in the musical, the whole time he keeps referring to like his other half. And so they just think that he's married, or that in this one they played it off like he had dogs or whatever.
Dogs,
apparently the whole time he keeps referring to his other half, and then at the end his husband like shows up or whatever.
That's better.
Much nicer and better, but instead it's played off as like the typical like he's gay gag, like haha, isn't
and
that
he makes
so
some
funny?
Joke about like I'm gonna have to come back to this island more often.
Yeah, like, oh, he's gay and he just fucked that random man, you know, like it's just like okay,
that's,
fine,
that's
like,
awful.
I hated it. Yeah, I really
that's
didn't like it.
Yeah,
really
it was awful. Bad.
If it was that, like, it would be very, very sweet because he tries to pay for the wedding and he wants to be a father, and he's like, it's meaningful for him of like. I never thought this was something I would have.
Yeah,
like some,
but instead they're like, oh, hey, he just realized he's gay right now. Like, and
there's literally a
gratuitous
like slow motion shot of because like a water main burst at some point.
Yeah,
everyone gets,
everyone gets wet. While
where
dancing.
Like Colin Firth is like shirtless hugging a random Greek dude.
Yeah, I hated.
He's
the
in
way
the
that
final
that
shot of the movie where they're kissing and he's just shirtless in the background, like yeah.
I just
I thought that was really funny.
I'm totally fine with the
Free
like,
Colin!
With the story being that one of these dads turned out to be gay, like that to me is great, but the way that they actually execute it in this movie I hated. So
yeah, like the fact that he was like in arrested development for his entire life and he had to come back to this island to realize that, like,
I didn't like
and then it was just like, oh, random guy.
Yeah. And so another change that the movie makes, I guess, is that the song with I keep wanting to say the wrong actress's name. Julie Walters. Rosie, you said?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. She,
Hercules Mulligan.
Apparently the whole... Yeah. He needs no introduction. I guess that song, Take a Chance on Me, happens earlier in the movie. And it's just a song with like her and Bill in like a bar. And she's like trying to get with him, basically.
That makes sense.
And I guess typically in the casting of the musical... that character is typically cast as a larger actress, and so then I guess it's kind of that whole comedy thing of like, here's this heavy set woman that's hitting on a man, like, you know, the Melissa McCarthy thing that people think is funny. And so then but at least it would have come up earlier, I think, you know.
I did
just, yeah,
I did, like, I was like simultaneously rolling my eyes and also being like, man, this song is fitting perfectly here, because like she you know, earlier in the movie had been like, oh, I'm not gonna like try to get with anyone, I don't care about that, I'm fine being by myself. And then she overhears that Bill is an author at the very end.
Yeah, they're both famous authors.
And then she's like, oh, and then she starts singing the lyrics, and it's like so perfect. She's like, if you change your mind.
Yeah.
It's like, you're also claiming trying to pursue a false immortality.
Yeah. And then it turns
publishing?
Into like a Tom and Jerry sketch where she's
like
chasing
him. I think
it's around.
Just the execution again. Like, if she hadn't been like weirdly chasing him and he looked like legitimately scared for his own personal safety. Like, if it had been more of a cute, like, you know, like if he had looked even slightly into it, it could have been a cute thing, but instead it just came off as totally creepy.
But I love how they like play off the, she's like, she sings the line, we can go dancing, and he like has a face like, we can go walking. Like, I love how they turn like what's just a regular song.
It's
a
weird
a
thing where it's like one of the last songs in the movie, and it's kind of when the movie really feels comfortable in the tone that it's set. And so it is this kind of Tom and Jerry thing, but it does exist. It feels comfortable in the world that they've kind of built, and it's slapstick and silly. And
yeah, they're like hanging off the roof.
Yeah, like it's
it's
not...
like in the middle of my wedding speech, I left to chase a man on
a
roof.
Danced on a table, and then
it's
fucking...
like it's basically like yeah, we got down with that shit. Fuck it, like now we're doing this, and it's kind of the movie has that air to it, and it kind of leans into it at the end here, and it didn't bother me because it didn't feel like that it was trying to be something other than this, which is all the movie is.
yeah,
in a way that was refreshing, I guess.
So yeah, then this is the scene, yeah, where like we said, the water main breaks.
Yep.
And they all dance.
Everyone gets wet.
Everyone takes their shirts off. I'm like, stop it. And then,
well, he's gay. Of course, he has to take his shirt off. Right. And
Austin
dance.
Takes his shirt off too. Like, yeah.
look forward to the gifts, guys. I know. There's some dancing gifts.
And then they reprise a couple songs, and we get like this encore performance thing at the end.
And this apparently happens on stage as well.
Which
always,
I thought was
yeah.
fun.
So they sing. They go into the credits singing Dancing Queen again, mm-hmm. right? And then what did you guys... Okay, so let's explain how this is.
Okay, so I want to talk about the transition of just going into the credits, where it's the silhouette of
she sings I Have a Dream again, and they're all taking off on various boats, right?
Yeah. Well, no, and then but then the silhouettes of Donna's group, what were they called?
The Dynamos.
Like... Charlie's Angels out over the moonlit water, and then it cuts to them in full disco gear.
Full ABBA gear.
Yeah, full ABBA gear.
That's how they're dressed.
Doing just like a music video.
Yeah, they sing Dancing Queen.
Yeah.
And then they get to the end of the song, and they're like, yeah!
One more song!
And like Meryl Streep is like up at the camera like, yeah, did you love that? Yeah! And then she's like, you want to hear another one? Like right at the camera, and... I remember seeing this in theaters, and I was like, damn, they were so confident that like people in the theater were going to be like, fuck yeah. And people were, when I saw this, people were cheering along. Cause like, it was those songs, like we said, are amazing. Yeah. So people are like on a high from that.
Yeah.
And then it looks like she's talking to you and people cheered, but like watching it here in my apartment by myself, I was like, this is so fucking ridiculous.
It made me feel dumb.
She's like, looking right at you like, you guys want another one? And I was like, nah,
watching
I'm
it on
good.
The train with my headphones on. I was like, no,
I'm good, Meryl. You can go now. I've heard enough. And then they bust into Waterloo.
Yeah. Because that's the one that, despite all best efforts, they're like, we really just can't shoehorn this one in there. Yeah. Like, it's about European history. Like, oh, just put that on the encore, which they do apparently on Broadway always as well. And they bring out everybody in funny costumes and, you know, whatever.
Oh, man. I just thought that was really funny. I just... You know, because here I am sitting in my apartment and it's dead silent.
You want another one?
She's like,
Justin Camps?
She's like holding her hand up to her ear like, what's that? Another song? You want another one? And I'm just like, totally silent. Ela's getting real excited.
Ela's
over
so
here.
Excited. She punched the microphone.
Ela's wanted another song. Yeah.
Sing it, Meryl. Oh, God. Sorry about that.
But that was so funny. And also, they bring out the guys who are just looking ridiculous as fuck.
Yeah.
Well, I feel like it's about that time when we talk about how we feel about this movie overall.
Yeah, probably.
And
I want to like
oh
I was gonna say I wanted to give like a quick aside about musicals during this time.
Sure.
So this movie came out in 2008, right? So the 2009 Oscars were produced by Bill Condon, who produced, you know, Chicago and a lot of other musicals. And he got Baz Luhrmann to, I think, write and direct this insane musical number to declare that the musical was back because of Mamma Mia and High School Musical 3. And so he got Hugh Jackman, Beyonce, Zac Efron and Vanessa Hudgens, and then Amanda Seyfried and Dominic Cooper to perform this, like, insane medley of like songs from famous musicals, but then also Mamma Mia and High School Musical 3 on stage.
I vaguely remember
in like Top Hats and Tails. And the one reason that I know a lot about this is because they got the USC band drummers to like stand in tuxes and like play drums in the background. And they were, I guess the Oscars were really insistent on that it had to be all guys. So the band was like, okay, any girls in the drum line, like you're out. We're just going to take random people like from the band that are men and like allow them to have awesome opportunity.
It's the Academy. So sure.
Yeah. Because, you know, they didn't dare say like, oh, hey, Academy, you know, no one's going to be able to tell their gender under Top Hats and Tails and drum harnesses. So why don't you just like take our girls? They were like, no, let's just bring in the random guys that are popular in the band. But anyways, the funny part about this thing is that at the end, like Hugh Jackman, like just goes like, the musical is back. Like that's like the final line of the medley.
Yikes.
Like it's just like... I think they were putting the cart ahead of the horse a little bit.
It's weird that they didn't get Pierce Brosnan for this.
Yeah, he should have.
He should have been there.
Yeah, it was rough. And I think it's just funny, too, that they included this dude, Dominic Cooper, like thinking that he was going to be like this young, like Zac Efron-y type guy to go on and do all these musicals. And like he did not.
Yeah. He's doing better things than musicals.
That's
okay.
Right.
Preacher.
Yeah. But, did you ever see Mamma Mia, the musical?
I didn't know. No, this was like during a high school, early college time for me, so I didn't have money or transportation or things like that.
My parents saw it in Vegas, which means that it was only 90 minutes. Mm-hmm. So
yeah, I think my parents, when this came out, I didn't even see it in theaters because I think I was at school.
Oh, no, I didn't see this in theaters.
Yeah, and so my parents bought me the, you know, bless their hearts, musical movie, they assumed. And so they just bought it for me for Christmas. And so I think I watched it once. And then I had, like, carried the DVD from house to house this entire time and not touched it until today.
Yeah. I was
they had a premonition that one day you're going to be talking about Mamma Mia the movie on a podcast.
I was graduating film school, so my nose was turned up so far away from this movie. I'm sure that I had strong
opinions. You didn't even know who ABBA was.
No, I
gotta say, I do appreciate it more now because I think I did know some of those songs back then, but I think now, like, knowing more of them and having a better sense of, like, what ABBA means to popular culture, like, I definitely enjoyed the movie a little bit more than I did.
I mean, I talked a lot of shit about this movie, but I had a lot of fun watching
it. It's fun. Like, it's so catchy.
Yeah.
On the train.
On the train.
With all your friends.
With all of my friends.
So, yeah, I mean, it was a really big movie musical. I don't know if the musical was officially back, and I still don't know if it's really back. Like, you get one here and there, but, like, there's not, like...
What about The Greatest Show?
The Greatest Show, man.
Yeah, I mean, that, to me, is there. And then, of course, you know, I'm sure you want to hear me talk more about how La La Land isn't really a good movie musical.
Whatever, whatever.
Justin's eyes just went, like, all the way back into his head.
I like that movie. All right. Well, okay, so we're at the end here. How many mystery dads out of 10?
That's exactly what I was going to say.
Yes! I was going to be like, how many three dads? No.
It was mystery dads. That's exactly what I was getting to.
Yes. We're in sync. Co-host sync. Yeah, Elis, how many mystery dads?
First of all, I have to say this whole mystery dad thing is really like a white privilege situation because ethnic people, it's pretty obvious who the mystery dads are unless they're all the same ethnicity.
I've seen that episode of Maury.
Who's my daddy?
But I guess I will have to give the movie, I want to be mean, but I also don't. Let's say...
be truthful.
Six mystery dads.
That's so high if you want to be mean.
That's so high
if you want to be mean. If
that
you,
is, yeah,
that was me being mean.
No, it's not being
that's
mean.
That's not
be
mean
truthful.
At all. Yeah.
I have to...
I'm not going to give it six, and I enjoyed it.
All right. Yeah, no, I'm going to say six because it's a musical still. I still thought the quality was good.
I went to the post office and sent out five letters to my five mystery dads.
If you had a dream list, who are your five?
Are the other two? Like, yeah. say you kept those three. Who would your other two mystery dads be?
Sam Raimi.
Yeah. That's a good one.
Sam Raimi and what about
Zac Efron.
No, you'd be his mystery dad. Okay,
I want him to be my dad. Okay, no,
I mean the one that I'd have on here, but if I include him in this ranking scale, that it would be completely skewed because it would be one of the greatest movies of all time. Is Kurt Russell? I want Kurt Russell to be my dad.
I think Liam Neeson would be a good mystery dad.
Ooh, Liam Neeson would be a good mystery dad.
Yeah,
you'd have a sudden urge to fight wolves. If you grew up with that urge,
once more.
That's true. Liam Neeson, was my mystery dad. If anything ever happened to me, like as if I was taken, you know, I'd be safe.
He would come after you.
But everything that ever happened to you would also be responsible by metachlorines. So
true.
That's the trade-off.
That's true.
I give this 4 mystery dads, with my extra mystery dad being Kurt Russell.
Fair enough. That's a good dad. Good dad.
That's a good dad.
He did musicals.
He did.
Mm-hmm.
And he was also a computer who wore tennis shoes.
Oh God! All right. Well, you know that's gonna bring us to the end here. Next week, we have a very exciting episode for you guys. We're gonna be doing another.
Here we go again.
Yeah, Mamma Mia! Here we go again. Literally. I was gonna say another brand new movie for you guys.
That's right.
Straight out of the theaters.
So, spoiler warning: we will get that out.
Yeah.
Front. Of the episode.
We're going to spoil exactly what happens when they go again.
And we're going to have a special guest. Special guest.
Who is it?
Womp womp.
It is my friend, Maureen Lee Lenker, and she is a writer for Entertainment Weekly.
Oh, ooh. Shit.
And also an actress and all-around good person.
Super excited to talk with her share our thoughts on going again.
Yeah, so... I mean, I hope you guys come with us when we go again to see. How many times can we?
All the times.
Here we go.
In the meantime, while you're waiting for us to go, Eliz, where can they find us?
As she says again.
Yeah, you can go again.
Tell us again.
Sequelrights.com for all of our episodes and email us sequelrights@gmail.com. We need your ideas for future franchises because this is, as we said, our first twofer. And you can find us on social media, Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook @SequelRights.
And please rate and review us on Apple Podcasts, wherever you get your podcast. We find your stars delicious.
And I realized the other day, I haven't been saying this for a while, but I'd like to thank my brother for the music at the top of the show.
That's right.
Who? What?
I know you guys love the theme song. He wrote it. You know, it might not be ABBA, but it's pretty good.
Jordan, you're almost ABBA.
So, again, I would like to say, next week, Mamma Mia, here we go again.
Here we go again.